Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the California ISO, I'd like to welcome you to the subscriber participating transmission owner model meeting to discuss the revised draft tariff language. My name is Caitlin McGee, representing Stakeholder Affairs Group here at the ISO, and I'll be helping facilitate today's meeting. I'm also joined by Deb Levine, Director of Infrastructure Contracts and Management. As a reminder, the materials for today's meeting can be found on the initiative webpage under the Stay Informed tab. Next slide, please. All right. A few housekeeping reminders for today. This call is being recorded for informational and convenience purposes only. Any related transcription should not be reprinted without the ISO's permission. This meeting is structured to stimulate dialogue and engage different perspectives, but we ask that you keep your comments professional and respectful and try to refrain from repeating what has already been said. Next slide. If you'd like to ask a question, make a comment throughout today's meeting, there's a few ways to do that. If you're connected to the audio through your computer or using the Call Me option, you can select the raise hand icon in the bottom right toolbar. If you are dialed in through an audio only line, you can press #2 and that'll add you to the queue. Or if you prefer, you can send your question or comment into the chat and I will read it aloud for you. If you do need any technical assistance during today's meeting, you can send a chat to the event producer and she'll help you out. Next slide. So here's a quick overview of the CAISO policy initiative stakeholder process. You can see where we're you know, further down the process. We've kind of completed the proposal development, which had been approved by the Board of Governors, and now we're working through the revised draft tariff language before filing. Next slide. So with that, I'll hand it over to Deb. We're gonna spend most of today just walking through the tariff language itself.
All right. Caitlin, can you see the Word document with the tariff language?
Yes. Maybe we can zoom in just a little bit, but
certainly
we can see it.
Is that better?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. So we the ISO went ahead and based on comments received from stakeholders and additional review internally, the ISO has gone ahead and is making a number of edits to the subscriber participating TO model draft tariff. The yellow, all of the edits in yellow are edits that the ISO made when we were rereading the document to be more consistent with the text that we currently have. So those are not stakeholder comments, they're comments that the ISO incorporated into this revised draft. And I apologize, I had originally planned on putting that in the note that went out, but it didn't quite make it. So I apologize to everyone. Okay, so the first comment that we got was from Transwest Express. They wanted to confirm that we did mean both planned or existing transmission assets. And yes, the ISO does mean both planned and newly constructed or constructed to meet California policies, which is part of the definition of subscriber participating TO. So we would keep planned or existing in that sentence. The next comment we received, and Caitlin, I can't see the raised hands anymore because I'm sharing. So if there's any raised hands, I'll pause after each replying to each comment and just let me know if there are any questions. That'd be great.
Okay.
So the next comment was from Six Cities requesting to move the word initial, which is right here, to down here after subscriber PTO. The ISO agreed and we've made that change. Transwest Express proposed defining the initial project as subscriber facility and coming up with a new definition. Our concern with that was that that would substantially change a number of things, and it got to be too confusing. So instead of that, what we did is we went ahead and we established that the subscriber PTOs, the initial project with the transmission component funded solely by subscribers, it's what's going to be used to provide subscriber rights. So hopefully that has taken care of the question with respect to making sure it's just the initial facility that has to have subscribers associated with it and not any subsequent facility that they're ordered or they're told to build. I guess we order them. that they're told to build in accordance with the transmission planning process or the generator interconnection of additional generators outside of the initial generator that's part of the project. So that's where we ended up with that. Then TWE proposed to delete the construction based on commitments, and we were concerned that using that term, we don't know what commitments are. In essence, the subscriber PTO has to go ahead and get their transmission funded solely by the subscriber, and it's not getting a commitment to fund it. They have to actually fund it. So we did not make that change to the tariff language. The next item, as you can see here, we had previously had other provisions. So the ISO went ahead and changed it to section 24 or 25, which are the other provisions that apply to that section, this verbiage of the this section of the tariff. So that way it's specific as to which sections apply are being cross-referenced as part of section 4.3.A.1. Don't ask me about the numbering, it's a legal thing. the next comment was to change original to projected as far as the subscriber PTO could be a projection that is already built, a project that is already built, and TWE proposed to change the original. The applicant will provide written regarding. Projected's down here. It's hard to, sometimes it's hard to read the, where the comments are. They wanted to change projected, which is here, to original. And what I did is I went ahead and added original or projected. And we wanted to keep projected to the extent that the project had already been. We've discussed a number of times the potential of an existing gen-only balancing authority area that would go ahead and join the ISO as a subscriber PTO after their gen-only balancing authority area has been built. So that's why we need to keep both original and or projected costs to build the transmission assets. And then TWE proposed a qualifier because at the applicant stage, the project may not be built yet. That's true, but part of the agreement underneath the applicant participating transmission owner agreement is that 120 days after they complete the project, they have to provide notice to the ISO of the actual cost incurred to build the project. So we didn't believe we needed to go ahead and make that amendment. And then Six Cities questioned why the information should be confidential. And the reason why that information is confidential is because of competitive reasons. Obviously, there's commercially sensitive information as far as what the costs are going to be or end up being, and potentially additional background information that we're going to request. And we believe that they should have the ability to make it confidential. Confidential means that they have to go ahead and mark it as confidential unless we mutually agree that all information is confidential. And in their rate filings that they'll make for their non-subscriber usage payment amount, they're going to have to go ahead and disclose some of the items, but some of the items they might need to retain as confidential. So we think keeping the words, the applicant may request confidential treatment pursuant to Section 20 as one of the options as far as the application and approval process is concerned is appropriate. The yellow here, we just went ahead and put in additional cross-reference so that the transmission assets and any rollover rights are specified in Section 3 of the subscriber PTO's application to become a participating TO. So in other words, the subscriber PTO, when they provide the application, they have to tell us what the encumbrances, amounts of encumbrances are going to be. They can't go ahead and say, oh, well, I'm going to have out of my 3,000 megawatt line, I'm only going to have 100 megawatts of encumbrances, and then come back and say, oh, I want to change that to 500. Oh, I want to change that to 1,000. When the application comes in to be an applicant PTO, and we then go before the board to get them approved as a conditional participating TO, they have to tell us exactly what the nature of the project is going to be, what the encumbrances are going to be, so that when we go before the board knows exactly what the project is going to entail. And so we just wanted to go ahead and add that additional cross-reference. TWE proposed a qualifier of putting projects. So item number two informs the CAISO in writing of the subscriber PTO's decision to not move forward with the projects becoming part of the CAISO control grid. We thought that was fine and went ahead and incorporated that. The next edit is in a number of places. Previously, what we ended up doing is this language used to say entitlements and used to provide subscriber rights. But it's not the entitlement that's used to provide subscriber rights, it's the subscriber encumbrance that's used to provide this subscriber right. So we made that change throughout the entire document. We just thought that that would be more clarification as far as it's the subscriber encumbrance that provides the subscriber rights. So you'll see that change throughout the document. We also caught a couple of typos and grammar. As an engineer, I will fully admit grammar is not my strong suit, and the attorneys are much better at it than I am. A number of stakeholders commented that there was no number four, and we went straight to number five. And what happened was is in our editing, we went ahead and one of the proposals was to make the applicant provide notice in writing to the CAISO of construction activities have begun and provides a notice to proceed to the applicant interconnected PTOs. And that was what number four was. So what we did is we just moved it back to number four because it is a separate step. They have to notify, the subscriber PTO will have to notify all of the interconnecting PTOs that they're moving forward, in addition to providing a written notice to the CAISO acknowledging that construction activities have begun. So that's why we made that edit. This is the same grammar, fixed a typo, some more typos. The next comment from stakeholders was from Six Cities and Transwest, requested to move the word when. When was previously, it was previously up here, eligible to apply when the TP deliverability allocation process, and then, oh no, the when was here. So the when was before one, and so we went ahead and put it in front of the one, and then we added in number two, going back and confirming what we had in our final proposal. We missed that the transmission owners have completed the interconnection studies before they can go ahead and enter the TP deliverability process, because we need to know what all of the upgrades are required, specifically within the CAISO Balancing Authority area, before they can go ahead and enter the TP deliverability allocation process. Transwest requested clarity on the steps the SPTO needs to take to be included in the TP transmission planning base case. Those we outlined in section 24.3.1 below, and the criteria is also established up in 4.3A3. So everybody shut your eyes for a second, so I'll go up to 4.3.A3 since it's closer. Okay, you can open your eyes now. Sometimes that makes me dizzy, so I tell people to close their eyes. So the steps for them to be part of the transmission planning base case is, one, the CAISO has to approve that, board has to approve that they can become a subscriber PTO. FERC has to accept the applicant participating transmission owner agreement between the subscriber PTO and the CAISO, which is very similar to the approved project sponsor agreement we have for competitive solicitation with some minor edits. FERC has to accept any applicable generator interconnection agreements for the generator facility. So that agreement has to be executed before they can get into the base case. Then number four, the transmission, the SPTO has to have begun the interconnection studies required by all of the transmission owners that they're interconnecting with, whether they're a participating transmission owner or a transmission owner that's not a participating transmission owner. And the definition of transmission owner covers both PTOs and non-PTOs. So I think we're covered there. And then the applicant needs to provide a notice in writing acknowledging that they construction activities have begun, and construction activities are defined by the tariff. Any questions so far, Caitlin?
No, nothing at this time.
Okay, all right. Okay, everybody close your eyes again. Oop, there we go, right there. Actually, let's go to this one, that's the next one. Okay, you can open your eyes. In this paragraph regarding the transmission planning process identifies the needs for delivery network upgrades. We had originally included in there only the resource portfolio requirements established by the CPUC. Six cities requested that we add or other local regulatory authorities, and so we agree, and we have added that in two places. and Meg and everybody who's on for Six Cities and actually all of the municipal utilities. I've been working with Jeff Billington on a list of all of the UDCs, metered subsystems, et cetera, that would have portfolios so that you can meet the renewable portfolio standard that we have. And we're looking to get a letter out before the end of the month to each of you requesting your what your portfolio requirements are for the next planning phase that we're getting started. So just a heads up on that. Additional text just to go ahead and clarify typos. TWE proposed to change the language here. Instead of the subscriber PTO must recover costs, to the subscriber PTO, we change shall the must, charge subscribers for use. And the we did not make that change because it's the subscriber PTO is not going to be charging anyone. All settlements are done through the ISO. We collect the money from the appropriate scheduling coordinators, and then we give the money to the subscriber PTO. So that change was not would not be applicable. And the additional language that TWE proposed was just made it more complicated from our perspective. In the CAISO, everybody is used to the way that we've been doing settlements now for 26 years. We charge, everybody pays, it's cleared, then everybody gets paid out on the same day. So we don't want to change any of that. The next one, Six Cities requested clarification that none of the original project costs are recovered through the access charge. The ISO agreed and went ahead and added the language that Six Cities requested. Here's the same change that we made above. Again, here, Six Cities requested additional language clarifying that any future additions and upgrades solely for the benefit of the subscriber should not get into the access charge, which we also agree to. Any upgrades that they're going to do just on the subscriber or O&M costs on the subscriber portion, that would not be included in the access charge. The ongoing cost for the subscriber PTO and its project is not going to be put into the transmission access charge at all. And we made a similar edit below and qualified both section 24, 25, and in DD so that we'd have all the cross references. So. The next one is TWE requested the agreement to be referenced here. We thought that was fine as far as, you know, scheduling of subscriber right transactions consistent with the subscriber agreement. That's the agreement between the subscriber PTO and the subscriber. So we were fine with that cross-reference. Here again, we just made a clarification, putting in specifically what the tariff section was that needed to be cross-referenced in this paragraph. Six Cities requested clarification regarding the intent of this section. The intent of this section originally was. Well, let's go back. the way that the intent of the tariff section today, before we add the subscriber PTO, was to cover non-participating TOs that had existing contracts with a participating TO and how those were dealt with as far as use and ownership of facilities were concerned. And so what we were trying to do is we were just trying to originally take the language that existed and just add in subscriber and subscriber PTO into that sentence. We understand Six Cities, after we read it more, we understand Six Cities' request for clarification and how it could be confusing. So as you can see, what we did is we deleted all of the reference to subscriber and subscriber PTO and just made a separate sentence. If a subscriber is a participating TO, it cannot turn over its subscriber rights to the operational control of the ISO and then get cost recovery of it. So as an example, if you had a participating TO, I don't want to pick on anyone and get in trouble. ABC, I don't want to accuse anybody of anything, but let's say that ABC decides to be get subscriber rights from the subscriber, the generator up there, and we just want to let them know that they can't then turn over those subscriber rights to the ISO operational control and therefore get cost recovery through the TAC because they're a participating TO, they're not the subscriber PTO. So hopefully that clarifies that section. That's what we were trying to do, not very artfully, completely agree, but that was what the intent was. Just better language. In 01234, the ISO reorganized the criteria to be in the same order that we had with the final proposal. I think that's why some people got a little bit confused. So we went ahead and did reorganize it. As far as item number four is concerned, Transwest requested that completed be changed to initiated. And this section is the section for the generator being able to get into the deliverability generator interconnection process and therefore be available for the transmission TP deliverability. So in that case, they need to have, this is the base case. So in the base case, you're correct, they only have to have it started to be in the transmission planning base case. TPD deliverability is down further. And then based on Six Cities' question about LCRIF, the ISO did some additional investigation and dug into, we only have one LCRIF, but Six Cities is correct. They could actually be an LCRIF if somehow they became a network facility that's solely for renewable generation. So we went ahead and took out the clause that said that the subscriber PTO didn't have to provide the annual report if they were an LCRIF. TWE had requested that we change governing board to CAISO management, and the CAISO can't do that. It's the CAISO governing board that has to approve it. The management can only approve once the transmission planning process, transmission plan has been approved by the governing board, then management can approve anything with capital costs below $50 million, that's correct. But the plan first has to be approved by the ISO governing board. We did add CAISO in front of it. That was one of our typos. And it's also helping us clean up some sections of the tariff that haven't been worked on in a while. This was just, this should have been yellow. We were just moving instead of direct here to here. So the CAISO may direct at its discretion the PTO and whose PTO service territory or footprint, yada, yada, yada. So better language. This is the same change we talked about above. In this one, what ended up happening is the attorneys, I thought that the apostrophe in it needed to be added. It turns out that legal determined that the change had actually already been made in the tariff. So this section is just deleted because we don't need it as far as the SPTO tariff language is concerned. Then in section 25, here's where we have the requirements needed for the generator interconnection and being added to the GIDAP base case. So Transwest Express requested clarification regarding the reference to transmission owner and not just participating transmission owners. In that instance, the completed studies need to be with all impacted transmission owners so that we know that the project is ready to move forward in order for us, you know, in order for you to start your construction activities, then you're going to need to know what the upgrades are by all of the impacted transmission owners. So we think transmission owners is applicable, not just the participating transmission owners.
You have a quiet group today.
I do. I was just going to say, Kaylin, do we have anybody?
No, not yet. But maybe as a reminder for folks, if you do have a question or a comment, you can raise your hand using the raise hand icon at the bottom toolbar, or just send something in the chat and I'll read it aloud.
These are the same changes that we talked about that we made throughout the document as far as subscriber encumbrance is concerned. Okay, six cities questioned how this could occur. So this section is a subscriber PTO has a transmission upgrade or addition that was funded by a project sponsor. The wheeling revenue allocated to the subscriber PTO shall be dispersed as provided in section 2414.4. And how this could happen is if the subscriber PTO ends up having a facility that might be an extension of their facility to someplace else that is part of the competitive solicitation, then you might have a project sponsor, and that wheeling revenue then would have to be allocated to both the project sponsor and the subscriber PTO based on the pro rata share consistent with the disbursement section of the tariff, which is 26.1.4.3.1. Do we have a hand raised at the moment?
Yes, we do. So Meg McNall with Thompson Coburn, go ahead.
Good morning, Meg.
Cities. So just to make sure I'm following, when I first read this, I think I was not thinking in terms. So the CAISO is going to study the subscriber PTO facility in the TPP, and it will make the determination as to potential upgrades that might be eligible for the competitive solicitation process, kind of consistent with its normal procedures, and that's kind of what this is getting at.
Well, I would say that the subscriber PTO, it's more like the subscriber PTO is already moving forward, constructed, and it turns out in, you know, 5 years, 10 years down the road, an additional expansion or something needs to be added in to one of the scheduling points that the subscriber PTO has, and that would then have to be competitive solicitation.
Okay. Yeah, I think I follow you. All right. Thanks for the clarification.
Sure.
And thanks for making all of the other changes to address our comments that you've gone over before during this call. We appreciate it.
No problem. And thanks to everybody on the phone. Really helps getting, you know, having one set of people look at it, you kind of have one side, getting the different perspectives and the different thinkings of other people were very helpful in really tuning up this tariff language. So it's greatly appreciated. We're not going to have a pro forma applicant participating transmission owner agreement. We've determined that there's probably going to be only a few of these, and it's not worth the ISO or stakeholders' time to go ahead and put together a pro forma agreement that has to go through a stakeholder review and then file it at FERC. And we were also concerned that we might need to tailor some of the agreements. So we'll just go ahead and file each one of the applicant participating transmission owner agreements with FERC and not have a pro forma. Six cities suggested a word change here instead of funded to paid, which is the ISO agrees with, that's a better word. And then Transwest Express commented that the clause was a bit vague. It needs to allow the CAISO, the clause, oh, this goes back to Transwest Express comment that the subscriber PTO would collect the money and based on our settlement system, it's the CAISO that collects all of the money from the non-subscribers, and then we would pay it to the subscriber PTO through the market clearing process that we already have as part of Section 26, which is the transmission access charge and the wheeling access charge. TWE suggested that we don't need to include this edit of including a new participating subscriber PTO because up in the definition of new PTO, we already have subscriber PTO up there. The ISO agrees, and so we've deleted this entire, changing this entire definition. As far as subscriber encumbrance is concerned, Transwest requested that we delete the text, if the subscriber PTO is not to risk incurring significant liability. We're fine with that. That was some language that had been talked about very early on in the process that kind of hung around and should have been deleted earlier. So thanks, Transwest, for pointing that out. This whole sentence is actually not needed in the definition of subscriber encumbrance, because that sentence already exists in the definition of existing contract. And then existing contract equates to subscriber rights, so we went ahead and took the sentence out. The second comment down here, Transwest, with respect to the first clause for a subscriber PTO, participating TO whose transmission assets and entitlements were constructed, we did add the word were. How would Transwest asked, how would existing transmission assets work as far as a subscriber PTO is concerned? And as we talked about earlier, you could have a gen-only balancing authority area that joins the ISO as a subscriber PTO after they've built out their project, and we don't want to preclude that from happening. TWE had requested a new definition, subscriber participating TO tariff. The ISO didn't want to put that in place because by the time the subscriber PTO tariff is in place, it's the same as a participating TO tariff, and participating TO tariff is already defined. So we don't believe that we need that definition. Here, six cities questioned if the specific rights associated with the subscriber rights should be spelled out. Because the rights are already tied back to the encumbrance, which is a parallel to the existing contract rights, we believe that the language that is there is already sufficient. And the encumbrance has to be defined as part of the original application. And it would also be, the encumbrance will be defined in the transmission control agreement when the subscriber PTO executes the transmission control agreement in advance of energizing the line. So we believe there's sufficient documentation as to what the specific subscriber rights are, and I don't believe we need to make that change. Six cities also questioned if the scheduling priority and perfect hedge needed to be added. From our perspective, they do not. Existing rights already has the, both in the tariff and in the business practice manuals for market operations, has already specified the scheduling priority and the perfect hedge. So we don't want to confuse things, because it's already in there for the existing rights and therefore transfers over to the subscriber rights.
Deb, we do have a hand raised from Bert Hansen with SCE.
Yeah, go ahead, Bert.
Gets to the encumbrance quantity, and I'm wondering, this sort of goes back to the beginning of this discussion, but is there any requirement that the encumbrance, total encumbrance relating to the subscription amount, has to equal the capacity as ultimately determined would be able to import into the ISO balancing authority or whatever, the current ISO BAA? Because there is a requirement that no original build cost be recovered through the TAC. And I'm just wondering what prevents a, to take an extreme example, the subscriber encumbrance only being 10% of the capacity, And at that point, this would be kind of implausible that the whole project could be recovered from the 10% subscriber. What prevents such a thing from happening? What term in the tariff?
We don't have a term for that. We weren't trying to be that prescriptive. If somebody, you know, is a billionaire and wants to pay for a transmission line out of their own funds and only have 10% encumbrance and 90% is available for the market, we wouldn't preclude that, but they're not going to be able to recover any of those costs in the TAC. And we have that a number of places in the tariff language.
Okay, so that's all new firm use at that point.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Any other hands, Caitlin?
Nope.
Six cities also proposed a number of edits in the subscriber rights section that resulted in us no longer mirroring the existing rights definition. And so we felt it was more appropriate to go ahead and have the subscriber rights be consistent with the existing rights so that it tied back better into all of the tariff language that we're relying on and wouldn't have to change any other additional tariff language. So we did not make those edits. Transwest Express, question why subscriber PTO was included in this definition. We went back and looked at it and agreed. And so we've gone ahead and taken out the entire definition. So it doesn't need to change, so it doesn't need to be in the tariff amendment. Moving on to Appendix DD, which is where we've got the TPD deliverability. We did, based on comments that we received from various parties up in the top section, went ahead and beefed up the market import capability to go ahead and address the question of a non-contiguous. So the gen-only balancing authority area that becomes a subscriber PTO because it gets transmission to actually interconnect to the ISO. So we've added this additional text in here to cover that scenario. And then in the second section, as far as delivery network upgrades are concerned. Six cities question, does this permit the subscribers skipping to the front of the line for the TPD allocation with respect to deliverability results from DNUs that will ultimately be paid by through the TAC? Edison had a similar question. And the answer is yes. If the generation associated with the subscriber PTO is meeting a portfolio requirement, then we're going to hold that delivery available. So as an example for Transwest Express, the CPUC has already come out with the portfolios for 2023-2024, where actually it was in 22-23, that they had the 1500 megawatts from Wyoming Wind. So that 1500 megawatts is being held for the Transwest Express project, but they're gonna have to go ahead and meet the TPD deliverability allocation process just like any other generator. So when they get into the TPD deliverability process, they're gonna have to, if they already have PPAs for all of their 1500 megawatts, then they're category A. If they don't have it, then they're a category D. And they can go ahead and park just like any other generator can park twice is what the current rules are. So we'll be using the same rules for the TPD deliverability that we use for existing generators as far as holding the amount of megawatts for the portfolio.
We do have a hand raised if you want to pause for a second.
Thank you.
Let's move to Meg McNall with Thompson Coburn. Go ahead.
Hi, this is Meg McNall with Six Cities. So just I think I follow the explanation that was just provided. So is this language getting at deliverability that is created by DNUs associated with the original subscriber PTO project as opposed to a subsequent upgrade that's determined to be needed that then results in DNUs?
Correct.
Okay. All right. I think I follow. I want to look at the additional language that it looks like you all have incorporated here, but I am following your explanation. Thank you.
Okay. And we tried to put more cross references in so that you could go ahead and see how it linked back into both the tariff and then section 8.9.1 above for the TP deliverability allocation process.
All right, thanks very much. I'll take a look.
Thanks.
We do have another hand raised from Cameron Yurkowski with Pattern Energy. Go ahead.
Good morning, Cameron. Yep, we can hear you.
Hi, thanks. Just a quick check on my read here of subsections B and C together. Should that be read as an or I guess like for a non-contiguous SPTO in this example in B, you would still be able to pursue subsection C as well, not creating like a new class of SPTO here that would be mutually exclusive between B and C. Does that make sense?
Yes, and the answer is yes.
Okay, thank you. Just wanted to check.
Any other? That's all we have for questions.
Great, thanks so much, Caitlin. Okay, moving down. Since we added the language up above here, we went ahead and deleted it from down here. Now moving into Appendix F, Schedule 3, which is the access charge and wheeling access charge appendix. So Edison commented that the subscriber PTO should never be allowed to recover any of the original costs for the project through the transmission revenue requirements. The ISO agreed, and we put in this whole new section that the subscriber PTO will not otherwise be entitled to establish any other element of a transmission revenue requirement unless justified for the recovery of costs associated with transmission facilities authorized underneath the TPP, which is Section 24, or the GDAP, which is Section 25. So I'm hoping that helps with some of Edison's concerns. Just reworking language. TWE comments that load pays TAC and not imports, which is correct. After going back, we must have had 4 or 5 meetings on this paragraph. After going back and forth, what we determined is this entire paragraph isn't needed, because what's going to happen is if you are a load, you're going to pay the TAC, and if you're an export, you're going to pay the WAC. And it's that revenue and then this next paragraph that goes that discusses the disbursement of how the subscriber PTO gets paid the non-subscriber usage payment amounts. So we were able to delete that entire Section A because it's already covered in Section 26 of the tariff. And this section should have been deleted. I apologize, it was one of my misses. When we agreed that the non-subscriber usage payment amount could never exceed the TAC or the WAC, I forgot to delete this paragraph. So that's why it's being deleted now. That was part of the final proposal. And I think I'm at the end. So with that, before we talk about any next steps, does anybody have any questions on the tariff language?
I'm not seeing any hands raised at this time.
Okay, fabulous. So Caitlin, I'll turn it over to you and I might add some additional comments. Or do you have another slide?
All right. After? Yeah, let's move to the next slide.
Okay, perfect.
All right, so here is the proposed initiative schedule. We added a commenting period here for the revised draft tariff language. That comment template should be posted to the webpage by the end of this meeting. And then we'll have another stakeholder call on the final.
No, we're not going to have another stakeholder call. What we're going to do is we'll take the comments that we received off of this revised draft and we'll incorporate the ones that we believe are applicable, and we'll be filing it at FERC. And we're gonna go directly to filing it at FERC. So we're not gonna have that next stakeholder conference. I'm sorry, I had thought that message had gotten to you, but it missed.
No problem, so we'll.
Glitchy computer at home.
So we'll scratch that last line and focus on the comment deadline for August 24th. So next slide. And again, so please submit your comments on the revised draft tariff language using the commenting tool on the initiative webpage by August 24th. Draft tariff language that we just went through is posted to the initiative webpage, so you can do your red line edits there and submit it through the commenting tool. Before we close out, Deb, we do have another question from Ryan Millard with Next Era Energy. Go ahead.
Go ahead, Ryan.
Sorry, there's a delay. Can you hear me?
Oh, okay. Yes, I can.
Perfect. Thanks. Deb, thanks for that clarification. So should we assume that you're going to target September for a filing and then likely ask for FERC approval for November?
Yes. It has to be sequenced in with the other filings that are going on in September. So we don't know exactly where it's going to be sequenced, but the hope is to get it filed in September so that we can get a order out before Christmas.
Great, thank you.
Certainly. Oh, John has his hand raised. Hold on a second. John has his hand raised. I might be
recorrected. No, you're not corrected. You're on track. We have a few specific dates to sort out, but that's generally the plan for the SPTO filing. It just needs to sequence in between several other things that are ongoing this fall. And we'll definitely be talking to staff about all of this. So nothing will be final until we get through that conversation.
Right. All right. Well, thanks so much, everybody. I appreciate everybody's hard work on this. This has been quite a slug for quite a bit of time, and appreciate your diligence and responsiveness.
All righty. Well, thanks for walking us through the tariff language today, and everybody for joining today's call. Have a great rest of your day.
Thanks so much.
Thank you so much. That will conclude our conference, and you may now disconnect.